Few would expect Alaska, with its great size and small population, to have difficulty disposing of waste products. But with a population growing by tens of thousands each year and rising industrial production, waste disposal is one of Alaska's greatest problems. Making sure waste materials do no harm to man or the environment is also a problem, one that is expensive and hard to manage. It is an irony that in this, the largest of the 50 states, there is so little area that can be safely and conveniently used to dispose of our waste products. This is the tale of two municipalities and their experience in handling some of the byproducts of progress. On the Kenai Peninsula, where Alaska's first petroleum and petrochemical industries were founded, there is a unique classification of wastes that require special handling. They are called special wastes. Special wastes are drilling muds discarded during oil exploration, fuel oil and non-hazardous waste products from petrochemical production. State law requires these special wastes be disposed of in a certified safe area. This special waste site, provided by the Kenai Peninsula Borough, is the only one of its kind in Alaska. It's located just outside the Kenai-Soldotna area near the small community of Sterling. The site has had a troubled history. Recently, some 400 local residents petitioned to close the site, fearing if the wastes drained into their water wells, they would be faced with a severe health hazard. Leading the move to close the site are Sterling residents Walt and Elsa Pedersen.
The Sterling site was made into what they called a special waste site. At the time this went in, they didn't make any explanation. It was advertised in the paper, one of those little legal notices, that anybody who had any complaints would be able to register them. But nobody paid much attention because nobody knew what a special waste site was. The first thing we saw was that these big ponds were being dug there, and a lot of very noxious looking oily waste material was being dumped there. And for a long time this went on and nobody paid very much attention. Then they built a fence around it, so it was you couldn't really see what was going on, and people began to worry about it.
We drew a 2-mile radius and we counted the wells that we knew, 97 wells in the 2-mile radius, and all mostly 100 feet lower than the hill where the dump is. And this started us worrying. And we live a mile and a quarter, and we're on the drainage from there, and the drainage goes on the other, north of us, and also south to the school and the public spring here. So we started writing to the new mayor, Mayor Thompson, and he sent me the complete file.
I received a letter from some people in the Sterling area that they didn't feel it was a safe situation. And then I went out to a meeting of the people in the Sterling area, visited with them, talked with them, and realized there was considerable dissatisfaction in the area, or concern about the site. Worry about it, I think, might be another term. They weren't sure what was disposed of there. In fact, some of them had strong feelings that other things other than just the special waste had been put in the site. And they were afraid it would contaminate their water table. They were afraid that it might in some other way create damage to the local environment. People had moved in closer and closer to the site. It was rather remote when we put it there. And as they moved in closer, they became more and more worried about it, perhaps. More concerned about it, didn't really want it in their neighborhood. So we, as a borough, decided to see if we could find a site that was more publicly acceptable and a little larger that could handle a greater quantity of drilling muds in particular.
The borough is not doing anything, and the Moose Range is in Washington won't do anything until the borough does something. And this is the kind of a standoff right now. Nobody is doing anything.
Right now, the land acquisition, as far as this is concerned, is somewhat on hold due to particularly due to the fact that we're watching the present site to see whether we really are going to need a new site or whether it's going to continue to get less and less material going into it. We may find in a year we don't need a site. On the other hand, we may find in a year that we are going to have to continue to find a new site for them.
In the meantime, until a new site is selected, the question remains in the minds of the Sterling residents. Does the waste site present a health hazard?
Manner of operation.
Bob Martin, regional manager of the Department of Environmental Conservation in Anchorage.
But I do think that the permit and the manner of operation described in that permit does afford the appropriate degree of protection for a facility of that sort for the users. It's not a bad site. It's got quite a bit of clay on it. It doesn't really have a lot of homeowners in the immediate vicinity, certainly not downstream. The water table is reasonably deep. All of those things are favorable characteristics for that particular site. And anybody who's been involved in the public process of trying to find sites to dispose of anything in this state or any other state for that matter, garbage or any waste products, knows that no matter where you put a facility of that sort, it's too close to somebody, and there's going to be somebody who doesn't want it there.
We have been told that unscrupulous operators have just dumped anything in here. And so when we started our campaign, we requested core samples be made of these ponds because we're not so much concerned about what they're dumping in now that everybody is aroused on the question, but we want to know what was dumped in 5 years ago. What's in the bottom of those ponds?
And indeed, it is possible. That's the purpose of the bottom sediment sampling program, to find out if we can detect anything in there that's been accumulating over time that was not supposed to be in there. And I simply don't have any results of that yet, and I don't know what that's going to show. All of our permits in the state right now are set up to require applicants or holders of those permits to submit monitoring information to us periodically. We simply haven't the staff to go out there and independently monitor everything that we've got a permit on. But for some of those that are, as you say, sensitive in nature, and I would agree that this is certainly one, and for our own peace of mind, I think we should go out there, sample trucks, and periodically as they come out, I think we need to take some bottom samples, and I've asked that be accomplished, and there's some technical reasons why we haven't been able to get that off the ground relating to gathering the sampling equipment we actually need and that sort of thing. But
Dave Brown, part owner of Alaska Environmental Industries, operates the Sterling Special Waste Site under a lease from the Kenai Peninsula Borough and a permit from the Department of Environmental Conservation.
There have been a lot of rumors flying around about hazardous materials going in here at night and so on. We don't do it. We've got, I have a partner, and the two of us between us have our entire lifetimes invested in what is right here and down in Kenai, and we're not going to jeopardize it by putting something here that doesn't belong here. Our biggest user of the site is Union Chemical Company. The people don't seem to realize just exactly what comes out here from Union Chemical. Let me say here and now that although they use this site very heavily, everything that comes out here has been neutralized by them before it comes to us. They have a series of ponds out there wherein they put their wastewater. We draw it from those ponds. It's considerably diluted, and they know what it is before they give it to us. Now, from time to time, they have something that they may have a question about, and they don't know whether we can handle it or whether we can't. And on that kind of an occasion, they will call us on the phone, and they'll say, hey, this is what we've got. Can you take it or can't you? And we don't tell them over the phone yes or no. We call the DEC, and we say, can we handle this or can't we? Down below us in the easement, we've got a series of about 8 monitoring wells. All of them have steel locking caps on top of them so that people can't tamper with them, and every 3 months we have an independent test lab that comes down from Anchorage and samples these wells to determine that, well, the direction of of flow of the water underneath the surface of the ground, and not only the direction of flow, but to decide whether or not what we're doing here is causing any problems in the water table.
Right now, there's no wells have been damaged or polluted. We're not worried about right now. We're worried about our grandchildren in 30 years. They'll say, why didn't they stop it when they were doing it? And when their wells get polluted, and the stuff is going in the ground and it's going somewhere.
But these people seem to think that this might someday be another Love Canal, and there's no way in the world that it could be. If you're looking for hazardous waste, go to the Kenai landfill, go to the Soldotna landfill, go to the landfills in Anchorage or Fairbanks, and don't blame the operators of the landfills for burying hazardous waste, because I have driven into the landfill in Anchorage many times. I've driven into the one in Soldotna and the one in Kenai. When you go in with a dump truck or a pickup truck that's loaded, they don't know what's underneath that load, and they don't ask. In Anchorage, they weigh you on the way in, and they charge you on the way out according to the weight that you went in with and that you did not come out with. There's nobody that monitors that load, and there's tons of stuff going into those landfills that shouldn't be.
This is the municipality of Anchorage, one of the fastest growing cities in America. But the refuse produced here is growing even faster. The landfill at Merrill Field will be full in 1985, and the city is faced with the problem of finding a new site, one that meets state, federal, and public approval. Meanwhile, each of the municipality's 204,000 residents produce more than 6 pounds of refuse every day of the year. That adds up to a problem of considerable size.
We're estimating about 220 tons of waste will be disposed.
Joel Grunwaldt is the director of solid waste services in the municipality of Anchorage.
If we were to construct a building around a football field, construct it 40 stories high, and compact the waste like we do at the landfill, we would fill that 40-story building surrounding the football field. Putting in it, the growth that Anchorage has experienced in the last year, another perspective, by September 4th of 1982, we had disposed of as much waste already in 1982 as we had in the entire 1981 calendar year. In 1981, we had a 23% increase in the waste quantity that went into the landfill over 1980. Again, in 1982, we experienced an additional 18% increase in the waste quantity generated by Anchorage residents. We feel this is primarily due to the construction activity and the growth that's occurring in Anchorage, not strictly related to the population growth. Population has only increased between 8 and 9% over this same 2-year period. So the landfill is really filling up much faster than we were projecting just a year and a half or so ago. In general terms, if we were to fill, buy land today to cover us from the period of 1986 through the year 2005, we will require 700 acres of landfill to a depth of 20 feet. Given the land values in Anchorage and in Alaska, that's a sizable capital investment if we have to purchase the land just to place our waste into it. I don't think we have adequately advised the public of the problems that we are faced with. We are hoping to change that around. The attitude that, like you say, out of sight, out of mind, that people have with the waste that they generated. We, all of us as residents, one day of the week to carry our garbage out to the curbside, and if it's picked up by either a private carrier or the government providing the service, as long as it's picked up, our concern over what we just placed out there ends, and it's somebody else's responsibility. But truly, it's all of our responsibilities to be aware of what is going on with our waste, and how can we help the community in taking care of it.
But the question of where the principal responsibility lies for taking care of our refuse and hazardous waste varies among the residents of the municipality.
We all should be concerned with it. We can't point the finger just at one group of people. We should do it everybody that wants to be claimed as Alaskan should be worried about Alaska.
I would think the municipality should take responsibility for making sure that hazardous wastes are disposed of.
I don't know much about it. I'm not sure if it's a real issue, if we haven't heard much about it.
Really, it's the responsibility of everybody that gets involved. The manufacturer, the merchant that puts it across the shelves, the fellow that buys it ought to be able to read, and usually there's things there. And we learn stuff as we go along. Of course, the municipality is part of the chain, and they have responsibilities and the particular expertise they're involved in, certainly. So it's all of us.
The center's real concern is...
Public interest groups like the Center for the Environment in Anchorage are involving themselves in the solution, but the prediction is that the municipality is faced with a tough issue in handling its refuse problems.
One that comes to mind rather quickly is the fact that Anchorage is in the midst of deciding where their next landfill will be. And this is not going to be an easy question to resolve, primarily because most of the land in Anchorage is either bought, sold, or it's tied up in some other interest. And we're going to have a real problem finding where we're going to put our waste. The Merrill Field landfill, to best of my knowledge, is going to be pretty much filled up in the next year and a half to 2 years. And we really have a space problem, and we're going to find a location that probably people are not going to be totally satisfied with, the whole not in my backyard syndrome. But I guess if anything, what we'd like to do at the center is to say we've really got to take the responsibility ourselves. It's going to be a slow process. We can't solve this overnight or within the next year, but it's going to be ongoing and a constant learning process, which has to be done.
If you have a designation of hazardous waste, if you have a good definition...
All of the government agencies and public interest groups concerned with hazardous and non-hazardous waste disposal unanimously agree that public awareness and properly defining the waste problem are keys to solution.
One of the best ways of dealing with those kinds of situations is exactly what we're doing right here today, and that is getting information out to people about what kinds of things that are, you know, hazardous, the PCBs, the pesticides that may have been used in the past that are no longer legal to be used, and that sort of thing. So a public information program, in essence, is what I'm saying, is to let people know what's harmful about the kinds of things they've got, and what they should do if they do have some of those things.
I think we need to have better definition, first of all, what is the hazardous waste problem, the extent of the problem, if indeed it is a problem. We need to quantify it in terms of the amounts and types of hazardous waste that are being generated and need to be disposed of in this community. Once we know or have a better definition of the extent of the hazardous waste in Anchorage, and then we can attack the problem much better.
I'm rolling along an Alaskan road. Hope you don't mind if I lighten my load.
One of the ways government agencies are trying to gain the eye and the ear of the public is with public service announcements like this one produced for the Department of Environmental Conservation.
Alaska for me.
If we all pinch in, we can do it as a team. Pick it up.
Information is also distributed through fact sheets, booklets, and news releases designed to stimulate awareness and synthesize the great body of complicated information about some of the problems Alaska faces in disposing of its wastes.
Alaska Health Project?
The Alaska Health Project was founded a couple of years ago in 1980, and the two things that we focus on are hazardous materials and workplace safety and health. We're getting a couple calls a day. They range from sometimes the state and municipal people who are interested in knowing more information. Sometimes it's a labor union. But more and more, it's the small business person or the household person who reads on a label that this thing says it's dangerous, or they say it should be disposed of properly. That's all it says, and they don't know what that means. What we can do here, in most cases, is quickly look up in our library what the material is, and then suggest to them some proper ways of disposal and some proper personal protective ways to use it safely. It's a very, very serious problem right now, which is affecting our sewage system and our solid waste system, as to what you do with these substances. They're not safe. The small business person, the household person, right now, unfortunately, doesn't have a great option in terms of how they should dispose of these things. I would suggest and strongly recommend that those people should put pressure on their local municipal and borough governments, as well as on the state governments, so that they have a reasonable program for which they can dispose of their materials. At this point, the things that the individual can do are inadequate, and what happens is that the half a gallon here, or the gallon here, or the tub of something in a variety of small businesses and households in Alaska is being dumped then into our sewage system or into our solid waste system.
Because small industry and individual homeowners dispose of potentially hazardous materials through the municipal sewer system, the city maintains a watchful eye on the effluent which passes through the waste treatment plant. Dick Hudson is manager of the primary treatment facility.
We collect, with a separate sampling crew, collect samples from throughout the sewage collection system, and more specifically at individual discharge locations, that is, at locations where individual dischargers discharge into the sewer system. Those samples are handled separate from the ones that are collected and analyzed for the plant processes.
When the field sample reaches the laboratory, a series of tests are run to determine whether dangerous pollutants are present.
We can calculate the concentration of that metal in the original sample and determine if it meets discharge limits based on municipal ordinance of concentrations that will ultimately affect receiving water.
We do investigate for the kinds of wastes that are readily understood, things like grease and oil, motor oil, for example, things like metal plating wastes, things like paint manufacturing waste. Those things and others like them, we do look for. We do monitor, we do sample and analyze samples from those kinds of industries. And up to this time, at least, we've found the strength of the kind of discharge those industries are making to be extremely low.
Historically, the largest contributor to Alaska's inventory of hazardous waste material has been the military. The huge military buildup in Alaska during the Second World War brought massive quantities of oils, solvents, PCBs, and chemical agents to urbanizing and remote areas of the territory. After the war, many of the sites were abandoned and the chemicals left in place. In 1980, recognizing the dangers to human life these chemicals posed, the Air Force began a multi-million dollar cleanup of the abandoned outposts. That duty has fallen to Captain Peter Robles.
And we form the teams together and we go out there and physically do the work, which entails draining transformers, checking out batteries, draining batteries for sulfuric acid, potassium hydrochloric, and other types of materials that are hazardous. We also do surveys of waste oil, drums, anything that we feel that may be potential. We also bring along the bioenvironmental engineers from the hospital, which have the technical expertise to tell us what's hazardous and what's not. through our experience, we've learned a lot, but still the technical expertise comes from the Elmendorf Hospital. We package these materials in the proper containers. Department of Transportation has strict regulations, plus the Environmental Protection Agency of the United States also has strict guidelines on how to transport materials. We follow these regulations and transport them in a safe manner through Air Force logistics back to Elmendorf for storage. We've cleaned up so far approximately 14 sites. We have more to go, and it costs the Air Force approximately $750,000 per year to clean up the sites, the program itself. This building has been designated the Hazardous Material Storage Warehouse. It's a place where all the materials that we recover from White Alice sites and other organizations, other bases in Alaska, are brought here for processing. From here, they go to the Lower 48 on a contract for final disposition. But we need a place to hold them and to store them. The building is special because it has to be diked so that if there is a spill inside, it is contained and we can clean it up. There are walls inside to protect, compartments inside to protect, special heating area if the material needs to be heated, it can't be stored in cold storage. The whole area is used to store hazardous material, whatever it is, and it's brought from all over the base.
The state and the borough and the federals have got to get together and sit out and plan for 100 years ahead. Not the next year we'll think of something.
The fact is, to really solve the problem, we've got to go beyond that, and we've really got to address the problem with open communication, because everybody realizes we generate waste and we've got to start dealing with it.
You know, it may be that we would need a place that is reasonably accessible at a reasonable cost for people who have got some things that just need to be controlled or need to be handled in some way in order to make sure that we don't get this midnight dumping of that people will have to do if they don't have any other reasonable options available to them. And so, you know, these are the kinds of things that I'm concerned about, as well as the industrial types of problems that we may be getting into.
The gap I see is that many people still think that the problem is not here, that it's not in Alaska, that the problem is in New Jersey, where they have the highest cancer rate in the country, or Los Angeles, where it's very really visible in the air. But the problem is not here in Alaska, and it is. And it might not be as gross or as huge as it is in other parts of the country, but it's here.